Hey, how's it going?
Sir, are you okay?
What? Oh, this? It's probably nothing. I'm sure it'll go away.
Go away? But, sir, that can't be good.
No, it's cool. Really.
Do you want a napkin or something?
Everything's fine. Thanks.
You wouldn't ignore this. So why ignore the signs of a stroke? At the first warning signs, call 911 immediately. Because time lost is brain lost.
Welcome to this edition of Lang's Perspective. I'm Mike Miller. My special guest today is a veteran of the broadcasting, radio, television for 64 years, Mr. Stan Robinson. Welcome, Stan.
Thank you, Mike. What a pleasure to be with you.
I'm glad you showed up today.
Well, you wouldn't miss it for the world.
It's been a long time. We were talking off the air, a couple things that you and I used to do together. But
yes.
You started... I mean, way back, back in New York. He grew up in New York. And,
oh, yes, New York State, yes. Cold Spring, New York, a garrison, combined communities there, so to speak. And just across is the noticeable part, right across from West Point, New York. And I got to see Blanchard, Davis, and Tucker. Some remember when I mentioned now and then publicly. But when they played for Army and so forth, I even got to see a couple games. And a little launch took us across the river. And by the way, we got to see a game or two even.
Wow, that's pretty neat.
I was just across the river.
That is pretty neat. We were talking about some of the people, we'll get to them, that you've met. And you've been involved with, went from New York to Coshocton?
Well, yes, I have to give my English teacher credit, first of all, Mike, because she said, I like your voice. I think you ought to go down to Peekskill down the road about a half hour, and I want to take you down there for a little audition. Well, that led to these 64 years eventually. Yes, after starting a couple years there at WLNA in Peekskill, New York, I'll always remember accurately, and then came the chance to move, and the letter came back from Coshocton, Ohio. I had answered an ad and brought Broadcasting Magazine, the national publication, of course, and at any rate, I ended up a program director for the time and chance to get into radio in Ohio. Hardly knew where Coshocton was, but I know now it's 70 miles northeast of here, and it's all very great, because I go to Ruskell Village still, right. And so forth.
Oh, absolutely. Okay. So when I talk to Bob Competti, he takes all the credit for your success. That's not true.
My agent, of course. Okay, well, yeah. He and JT are my agents.
Yeah, we didn't want to say that. And you spent about 6 years in Coshocton. And then went to
Zanesville. City of the Y Bridge, yes. Yeah. People would ask directions as visitors, and now and then I remember the news director and I, we used to tell them, well, just go to the Y Bridge and turn right. But at any rate, that was good for a lot of years. But at any rate, that did that provide a great opportunity, because the day that General Manager Alan Land called me in Coshocton and said, hey, want to learn how to do TV? I said, well, I'd love to learn how to do TV. Well, of course, we got it together, and I was program director, as I say, during the day for radio, and at night, the 11 o'clock weather on TV for WHIZ, Good old Wiz. And it was cute because I was sponsored, the weather segment was sponsored by Ohio Power Company, I'll never forget, and I had to have the Ready Kilowatt necktie on every night.
Ready Kilowatt, well, I haven't seen that in a long time.
Ready Kilowatt necktie, I'll never forget that, but it was always fun, yes.
And then after a few years in Zanesville, you made the move to Channel 4.
Well, a couple of years, and that phone call seems to be a lucky key for me, because another call came one night after the 11 o'clock weather, and it was Channel 4, and I was quite shocked and pleasantly surprised. And at that time, the program director said, hey, we kind of like your style, like your voice there. We're going to start the local weather here. And that's why I point out to you again that a lot of people don't realize, and no reason to, that I was the first local weatherman, long before Mr. Ganahl, Mr. Gelber, right. All those are good guys, mm-hmm. But and gals. But anyway, that was an opportunity, because I got to accept that offer and audition and so forth. And they said, yes, we want you to take the 6 o'clock spot there and 6 and 11 at night, and they will have Jimmy Crump with you and Hugh DeMoss in the news. Mm-hmm. And I said, great. Well, that led to 10 years.
Wow. And we were talking, some of the people you've met, through your career. I know you met a lot at Channel 4.
Oh, yes, because they had a working agreement with the Kentley Players. Mike, you probably remember, as most folks would maybe, but at Elf Memorial every week there was a new production, a big-name star every week, and it was the Kentley Players' famous production. But at any rate, yes, Channel 4 had an agreement that every Tuesday on the morning live audience show that I helped out with, the fact that they would have the star had a commitment to come out to Channel 4 and do a piece of the morning show. Well, of course, it just led me to such folks as Hugh DeMoss, Art Linkletter, went on and on as far as opportunities to meet these kind of people and so on. And Phyllis Diller, of course, was an experience in itself. But you want to hear about that
one? Yeah, I'd love to hear about Phyllis Diller.
Phyllis Diller.
Some of the crew have no idea who Phyllis Diller was.
I understand it. Yes, that's right. But at any rate, Lady Comedian, for sure. But at any rate, she was appearing in Columbus that week. And the fact is that I said, oh, my, Phyllis Diller next Tuesday. Oh, my gosh. Well, word got out to the public as we promoted it a little bit. And I'll tell you, that audience of 150 ladies, they were just ecstatic, of course. So Miss Diller arrives, and we were on from 9 to 10. And she arrives at the studio in great hoorah and hoopla, and in she comes. And so I said, now, fellas, if you sit right there next to me, I said, we'll just do it casual format here. And she said, sure, go ahead. So anyway, we get the show started and a few laugh lines in between. But I said, you'll pardon me, Phyllis, I've got to do a commercial here for one of our fine sponsors. She said, well, certainly. So I said, Conn's Wieners presents this portion. And the fact that in those days we didn't switch to, you know, video or anything like that. We did the live spot.
Right.
So I had the package of hot dogs here. She said, hold on just a minute, Stan, I want to help you. I said, well, okay. And they all start to laugh and gave, you know, and she opens up the package, and I thought, well, here, what's coming here? She takes out a hot dog, dips it in my coffee. She said, that'll taste a lot better now. I said, there goes the Conn's account. I'm in trouble. And the audience goes crazy. So,
oh, that is the what was it? She called her husband Fang?
Oh, yes, Fang.
It was
yes,
what she
yes.
called her husband. I always liked that. I thought she was always
one. Oh, my goodness. One of a kind.
I mean, I was very young, but I just thought she was
one of a kind. And then when Mr. Hugh Downs, who always admired Hugh Downs, of course, and from Lima, Ohio, incidentally, but Hugh Downs was a guest. He was, I'll never forget somehow, he was in Under the Yum Yum Tree. It was the prep play that he took part in at Vets Memorial that week. But anyway, he sat down. I was so happy to see. I've got the picture to prove it. He sat down on the set, you know, and I said, well, welcome. And the audience was quite thrilled to see Hugh Downs. And I said, hey, pardon me. I looked down. I said, you've got one green sock on and one red sock on. He said, yeah, I got another pair home just like it. My wife doesn't travel with me, so I'm colorblind.
Oh,
Hugh Downs from Lima.
That's pretty good.
And then Art Linkletter, of course. Art Linkletter, at that time, very very famous for his house party show on national television. And the fun there was that he actually had all kinds of stories to tell. And I said, Art, why don't you go out in the audience and talk to some of these local folks and so on. Well, they were all thrilled because, and I have that picture, he's out in the audience. I just turned him loose, you know, let him interview some people on the show. So that worked out fun. But the big story, before getting to Channel 4, the big story in Coshocton was, if I may, that two things that I think some of our viewers would enjoy hearing, familiar names anyway, but you picture in Coshocton now, okay, the GE plant at that time, not there anymore, but south of town in a little village of Conesville, and a sizable plant at that time, but anyway, the PR man for GE at the plant called me and said, hey, next Friday, he said, would you like Ronald Reagan for a guest? I said, beg your pardon? He said, actor Ronald Reagan. I said, boy, my goodness, would I like it. Anyway, Ronald Reagan was on this CBS theater on Sunday nights, I'll never forget. But anyway, Ronald Reagan came in, and I did the radio show each Friday across the street, as happens, in the 6th Street Theater, which was there forever. And so Ronald Reagan, on he comes, and I had a little trio of music folks with me every week, and on the stage that day, they gave a little salute to Mr. Reagan as he strolled on the stage, and the crowd went crazy, of course. But anyway, that was memorable, and all-time, not the president now, but the actor.
Right, the actor, who later became the president.
Yeah, that's right. And then one day in Coshocton, because I did some news and sports, of course, along with being a program director, and the fact is that they said, now, Stan, next week we're going to do that Little League championship game there up in West Lafayette, which is 6 miles from Coshocton. And I said, oh, okay, all right, we'll do that. Yep, yeah, we got that sold. He said, and you got a color man now. He wants the guy doing some color for you. He just wants to do a couple innings with you. I said, well, you know, I'm a baseball fan, so baseball fan. Yeah, and so they were talking about the names, you know, and I said, well, who's come out? Well, Cy Young will be with you for a little baseball coverage.
Cy Young?
Yeah, I tell that people the story, that public story, and people do just, you know.
Wow.
But that was fun. He did a couple innings with me, you know. Oh, but
that is amazing. Now, and you've gone to Las Vegas and you've met some interesting people there too.
Well, I think of these several years my dear wife C and I did enjoy having fun and just being tourists, typically. But friends of Lancaster with us at this one occasion, my goodness, yes. The Stardust, of course, no longer there. But the Stardust, we got to be in the front row thanks to these folks from Lancaster, good friends, obviously. And Mr. Don Rickles, I'd wanted to meet him. Oh, I laughed at him on television for how many years. But anyway, that night he leaned over and shook hands and so on, and that was real fun, you know, just... say that that happened.
That is amazing.
And in the Stardust Theater area, that one memorable night a couple of years after that, that of all things, my wife and I were sitting right there, and Robert Goulet leaned over and sang to my wife briefly. So it was.
Wow, that is fantastic.
Didn't even get an autograph.
That's okay. I know there's been a lot of things go on in your life. In 2011. I guess was a high point, also a low point.
Yeah, appreciate
for you.
That. Yes,
mm-hmm. Low point, obviously, the passing of your dear wife.
Precisely to 2011, and the way the sequence went. Yes, you hit that description nicely there, because 2011 June 5th, Sunday, a big luncheon gathering in Columbus, and I had been represented there by a nomination for the Associated Press Ohio Hall of Fame, right. And I was so excited. And that happens to be that was written by dear Karen Kessler from right here in Lancaster, mm-hmm. who I watched grow up and so forth. And Karen Kessler is of course the voice of the State House. She's on the network for the public radio at the State House. But at any rate, she had submitted the entry, and I was chosen and entered the Hall of Fame of the Associated Press of Ohio. So that was a memorable Sunday, June 5th. And then June 29th, I lose my dear wife. So June was, yes, sweet and sour.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That was in all the accomplishments, and, you know, when you're growing up, did you ever think you would be in radio and television? Did you ever...
I was pretty much convinced comfortably after being very nervous in Pittsfield, New York on the opening start, let's say, of all things, because my English teacher up in Cold Spring, New York, where I graduated, and just up the road from Garrison, she said, you know, I like your voice, I'm going to take you down the station. That's how that got started. Mm-hmm. So at any rate, always grateful for her, but then nerves settled pretty well, and, you know, from Coshocton to Zanesville, chance to go to Columbus and do TV and so forth. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you a quick story too, Mike, that on the TV circuit there, as nervous as I was when the actual meeting came with Mr. Jim Leonard, the general manager of Four at that time, and he welcomed me, and they said, now you're going to work with Jimmy Crum, he said, of course, and he was the boss at night, 6 and 11. I said, well, sir, that's fine. He said, now, I've discovered a few people. He said, I was in New York, of course, in the network business for a while. He said, I founded the Mills Brothers. So that got my attention. Rosemary Clooney. Oh, I said, yes, all right. I said, I like that company. You know. But that's where the entree is to Channel 4 and so forth and those memorable years. But it was something to work with Mr. Jimmy Crum, legend. He only spent 45 years at Channel 4. You know? My goodness. And dear Hugh DeMoss. But Jimmy and I did have some experiences. If you have time, I'll tell you a cute one.
Sure.
We were invited to speak publicly, of course, either one or two of us, you know, at a time sometimes. And in comes the letter one day to the Channel 4 Promotion Department. Now, we'd like to have the weatherman and the sports guy, Jimmy, come and stand together. And it's a big night. Well, it was a service club gathering, and it was way up north. And I know that the Channel 4 covers about 30-plus counties, mm-hmm. as the others do. But anyway, the fact that we said, hey, we'd like to do that, it sounds like, well, we'll go together. I'll drive. Okay. So the night comes. They give us the night off. And they fill in on the sports and the news and weather and so on. But a memorable night was, we head north, and Jimmy said, Versailles? Well, I said, I've heard of the Treaty of Versailles. I suppose Versailles might have Versailles. Well, he said, we don't be embarrassed now when we get there. And then, no, I said, so we got a good hour and a half, almost 2 hour trip. And we get closer. He said, as you do, he said, now you see some bright lights pull in or something, let's ask somewhere. And I said, yeah, I think you're right. We don't want to be embarrassed. So we pulled into the first bright light I see, and the landlady says, "Yes, gentlemen, could I help you, please?" I said, "Yes, ma'am. We're happy to be in your fine city tonight. Could you tell us where are we?" She looked around. She said, "Dairy Queen, I think." That's a true story. Oh, Crumb says, "We're not asking directions ever again."
That's pretty good.
That's a true story.
was there ever a time when you were doing this that you thought, maybe I shouldn't be doing this. Maybe I should be doing something else?
No, it truly was dyed in the wool here because, think of it now, high school, you know, getting out at a young age, a little nervous and scared, yes, but, so excited when the things started to tick and come together, and it came in sequence pretty nicely. I'm really thankful for it, that's for sure.
Yeah. When you retired, because you came back to Lancaster and worked for Dick Shore,
right.
And then you worked for, that other guy, what's his name? Oh, Capetti.
Oh, yeah. Get that cue card up, please.
did you watch TV in a fan, or did you watch it as a critic of the other Weathermen?
Fan today, everybody has their favorites and so on, and the type of show, but the sitcoms, I still love the sitcoms, yeah. I was, anything I could watch in the sitcom field and enjoy a good laugh and so on. Not too serious material, obviously, but, I enjoy it, have always and still do.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So what did you do in your spare time when you were not on television or on radio? What did you...
Well, we lived in Hilliard for those 10 years while I was at Channel 4, and in other words, involved in the community somewhat to a degree, and with the wife and several children and so on. We just never had a dull moment there and so on. And Hilliard in those days, of course, was one barbershop, one pizza shop.
I was going to say, it had to be a little different than it is today.
And walk up to the Big Bear for groceries and all I remember, and then nothing else was there. Today, you can't hardly get through there without traffic problem.
That's we're talking with Stan Robinson, a 64-year veteran of broadcasting, just talking about some of the things that have gone on in his life.
And last year, for example, right here in Lancashire, of course, which I've dearly loved now, 44 years precisely of that timetable of Mike. But anyway, picture, if you will, last year, one of our fine service clubs, I'll not release the name right at the moment, and the chairman, of course, said, "Well, now, everybody knows Stan. Mike, we don't have to," I was going to speak at the luncheon, and he said, "We don't have to give Stan a big lead in here," and so forth. After all, he got it started with Alexander Graham Bell.
Oh, gee. Did it ever bother you to be famous? Did ever people come and say, "Oh, that's Stan Robinson"?
Well, I guess the proudest thing, and I say this in all honesty, it's just a pleasure and privilege, as it happens and did a couple of times just last week and so forth, because I'm so indebted to the Fairfield County Ag Society and Fair Board. I've just retired from 30-plus years as the public relations man, and my dear friend Sue Smith, of course, working with her LOH and interface for how many years collectively, but she's still young, of course. But anyway, Sue is now the new public relations person for the Fair Board, and I'm just going to doodle helping out on the sideline. But at any rate, the Fair Board, when I received the Russell Ault Award a couple of short years ago, and so on, for contribution of time and effort to the fair, but love that fair, that's for sure, and I've had some great experiences there. But do you remember on Channel 4, Doug Adair, the newsman, and Mona Scott?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Yeah. So, all right, picture now, I'm so excited because I would do a 12:30 to 1 piece of radio every day, and there ended up being some TV as well. So, at any rate, picture, if you will, they were agreeing to come down. Channel 4 said, "Hey, they'll come down and do the show with you, Stan." So, at any rate, down they came, and the show went through just fine. Half hour, big audience overflow, standing 10 deep out back, But at any rate, they go on their way, and Stephanie Bucher, dear Stephanie, was our news director at that time. And Stephanie was backstage during the show, and she came running out through as I was just shaking hands with some people. And she said, "Stan, there's been an accident." I said, "An accident?" "The plane went down." I said, "Doug and Mona," she said, "Well, yeah, they came to the Lancaster Airport with a helicopter and so on and had to get back to Columbus." And I said, "The plane went down." Well, it turns out the panic set in quickly, and as the pieces of the story fell together, the fact is that the helicopter, the Channel 4 helicopter, had crashed on the freeway just entering Port Columbus, going back home, taking them back up. But at any rate, they weren't hurt, thank goodness. And they were on their way. I didn't know it until after. They were going to catch a plane and go to New York for some NBC promotion deal. So anyway, that was a one big scare on that particular occasion for sure. But we got through it all right.
Wow. And now kind of... Not semi-retired because you're doing some radio with 90.9?
Well, yes, I'm so thankful to Pastor Z. Brown, and of course I enjoy you and Steve on TV here every week, but I'm just saying that, yes, a pleasure and privilege, and as I mentioned to you earlier, it was no better time than that first week of September when he said, let's get something started here, and if you're willing to come out of retirement. I said, it'd be more than a pleasure. So, yes, that's been rewarding, very rewarding.
Has there ever been anybody you wanted to interview or have on? I mean,
Well, the sports figures and some of the other names, I think two items come to mind quickly here in Lancaster. Mr. John Glenn and Mrs. Glenn at the old Lancaster Hotel, and one given even for a political gathering they were here for, and so on. I had my LOH microphone in hand. And then down in Cincinnati, the Ohio Association of Broadcasters always hold one of their two meetings a year in Cincinnati. Happened to be at the Kings Island Inn and so forth. But at any rate, yes, I was on the board that particular couple of years, and how nice could it be? Mr. Neil Armstrong was to be the guest speaker. Now, this is at a juncture of time, only I'm going to do this roughly. Only I just remember he was teaching some science classes at the University of Cincinnati. But more importantly, to interview Neil Armstrong with my little tape recorder, I'll never forget. I mean, bashful, shy, retiring, I say respectfully to that great hero. But again, bashful, shy, retiring, soft-spoken, so gentle, you know, just it was a really nice experience, of course, after what he went on into but and had done. But anyway, that was just a couple of the people that really stand out.
Did you ever interview somebody that was totally different than what you thought? I mean, other than you talking about Neil Armstrong, but somebody just, boy, this isn't what everybody told me about?
That's a good point, yes. The Ohio Association of Broadcasters, which I was active with, of course, I say, for several years, and the fact is that I had the fall luncheon in Columbus one year, and Ted Turner was the speaker. Well, I mean, very, very aloof and kind of quiet and cool and not fun to interview, I'll put it that way. Uh-huh. And I was a great Braves fan. But anyway, which I told him that, it didn't influence him too much. But no, just one of those people not totally comfortable, you know.
Do you follow sports? Do you follow baseball, football?
Cincinnati Reds fans. Now, the Indian fans will be booing, and maybe JT included, I don't know. But the Reds, yes, and Bengals. I like to watch the Bengals.
Did you watch the Super Bowl?
Oh, yes, yes, yeah.
Did your team win?
I was interested till the lights went out, you know.
I actually got home, and one of the kids said, well, the lights went out. I said, here in the house?
Oh, 35.
They said, no, in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, 35 minutes.
Yeah. You know, somebody's had a role for that.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. And I never will get over it yet. This year, for the first time, not 350,000, but 4 million for a 30-second spot. You know, that seems like a little expensive.
Yeah. That's a lot. Does that surprise you? I mean, the cost of just even operations of a television show?
Yeah, well, sometimes it has been an effect on my thoughts and memories now, but not always. But nationally, it's out of hand as far as I'm concerned. But
you told me a little bit earlier that when you were at Channel 4 that one of the reasons you actually got kind of moved back to Lancaster was contracts, because you always had like a 3-year contract,
and then it got
changed, and Jimmy Crum had to give you the news that they were going to do 1-year contracts?
We had a union, because American Federation of Radio and Television Announcers, so AFTRA was our group, and Jimmy was our steward. That's why he went to the big meeting and came back the next day and said, guys, I got bad news, it's only going to be a 1-year contract. And I say three of us that had families certainly started looking right away because it was scary, you know. Mm-hmm. But 1 year only, and like you figured maybe you might be out the door, you know, and so forth if something happened. But,
and then you came back and worked at WLOH for a number of years.
30 years, yeah. Mm-hmm, proud to say. Mm-hmm. A lot of experiences there. And when I got started as news director, Dick Shore said, now, first of all, Dan, you'll get to do some basketball. you can help out with that this fall. And they said, because I came in the springtime. And he said, then let's see, football. Yeah, you can work the football circuit, too, and so forth. So people like my dear friend Jerry Lehman all these years, who's, of course, still here in town, and Mr. Carl Heister up there in Winchester area and the Lithopolis. But anyway, they were with me much of the time, and we had some great experiences. Yep.
And then from there you went to Interphase, and you had to put up with Bob for great. A number of years.
It was a pleasure to put up with Bob, because a great invitation that it was. It led to the 5 days, half hour a day, five different sponsors hopped on, and my goodness, yes, very, very memorable experience for the 12 years, yeah. Oh, yes, wouldn't trade it for anything.
When you look at today, we've just got a few minutes left, but when you look at today and some of the, you know, the announcers are on, and does that bring back memories when they were, you know, maybe a little younger? And
yes. You know, that's a good comment, because the younger generation, we notice on 4, 6, and 10, and I say we are radio crew at 90.9 and everywhere else in that circuit, so to speak. I know that people in our vintage age, those two in my area, for example, say, boy, the young people are really coming on. Well, it seems like the big names that we've known maybe for a while are now lesser names, folks who deserve a chance on getting started, of course. But that's noticeable to me and so forth. Now, being on every night, of course, with the weather element in particular at Channel 4 those 10 years, and I'll never forget some of the things that happened to us, because other things I haven't told you, because the one night, for example, we got this very complimentary letter, Marysville, Ohio. Okay, fine. Marysville, Ohio, and the lady said, oh, Mr. Robinson, we certainly enjoy your weather and Jimmy's sports and Hughes News and so on. And I thought, well, I'm going to read this on the air tonight, because this is a very, very special, nice letter. And the boy said, yeah, go ahead, read that. So I did, and she said, now, we have a favor to ask, and I hadn't told Jimmy and Hugh this, and I said, all right, on the air, a favor, yes. My daughter is planning a garden wedding in September. Now, it was only the first week in April, I'm reading that springtime coming, and she said, a garden wedding in September, would she be safe in doing so, meaning the weather, obviously.
Right.
And I paused and looked down, I said, you know, Mrs. Jones, at this point, I'm not even sure she's marrying the right guy. And Jimmy and Hugh broke up completely.
Is there something in broadcasting that you thought you'd never see? I mean, when you started out and you thought, well, and when it came out, it was maybe it was a new camera or maybe it was a new microphone or something, and you just thought, well, I never would have thought you came up with that.
Well, in my truly humble, honest fashion, I would only say simply, as I've said to many good friends and family members over the years, the fact that I didn't know the high-tech world would become this high-tech, you know, because it's not for me, and that's it's just the way it is. I mean,
you've been around a long time. Is there one thing that you can really remember that you just, wow, that just set the generation or that made... I can't believe that happened.
I guess I'd be only happy and thankful the rest of my days that I had the chance, step by step, and all these things, I say, like blocks, fell into place, orderly so, and it just worked out great. I mean, I'm so thankful. And as far as the experiences, television and radio, to be able to do both, not just one,
right.
But to be able to successfully do both, you know, I'm happy, so happy to my final days, believe me.
And if you hadn't done broadcasting, what do you think Stan Robinson would have done?
You know what? Now, this, yes, you are asking a real dated question properly, because you know what? My dear wife, my five daughters would tell you today, in two sentences, the fact that, yes, I'd like to be a Marty Brenneman.
A Marty Brenneman, okay.
Baseball, yeah,
because
that's my favorite of all.
Yeah.
I would have done that, yeah. And I'll never forget, back in 1972, I think I was president of the chamber, and so I helped plan the banquet, of course, and the old Buccaneer restaurant.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You're probably too young to
remember. No, I remember. I'm 22, which is now the Eagles.
Right. Yeah. Exactly right.
Yeah.
And the banquet was to be out there, but my point there is 200 people. We've got a crowd of 200. Mike, we thought, boy, this is big. I mean, really.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And I brought to town Marty Brenneman, because LOH had the network, of course, the Reds network for how many years? Still do. But anyway, Marty Brenneman came to town, and he was happy to do it, and that was. A very successful evening to remember with somebody like Marty Brenneman.
That is neat. any advice to young broadcasters coming up today?
You know, I think only the fact that the opportunities are out there tremendously. I mean, it's got to be an open door out there because it might take a little time. But, I mean, these schools of broadcasting and, I mean, it's just Dallas, our morning man at 90.9, he teaches at that broadcasting school outside Columbus every day. And, my goodness, he tells interesting stories about how talented some of these young ladies and some men are, you know. Mm-hmm. Just like we have some here, this obviously a nice studio.
Right. Yeah, they do a good job. Crew does a good job here.
Yeah, right.
Well, Stan Robinson, it has been a pleasure to have you here today.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
Reminisce about old times, and we talked about some TV shows that I messed up when Bob came to Job and Family Services and asked me never to do that again.
And my quick hero, of course, picture of the week after, no, week, month after I was, you know, before, they said, now you're going to meet Miss Lyons. I said,
that's right.
Ruth Lyons? The Ruth Lyons? Yes, yes. And she wants you to come down next week to Cincinnati, and she wants to welcome you as the new weatherman at Channel 4. And I said, well, boy, it would be a privilege for sure. Well, you know, I told you earlier, the combined audience daily for radio and TV for Miss Ruth Lyons, as some folks will remember, but the audience numbers were 7 million a day on radio and TV.
Wow.
And watching and listening. Well, the point is, I got on stage, I've got that picture, I've got on stage shaking hands, and weatherman Tony Sands was part of the welcome I received, and he was out there standing there. She said, now, Stan, I've tried to help Tony all I can, and everybody starts to laugh, you know. I said, well, that's fine, Ms. Lyons. She said, yes, I put a window in the weather room so he'd know if it was raining or not. Crowd went crazy, of course.
Oh, that is fantastic. Well, we will have to have you back on again, and, you know, we'll reminisce again about all member of the 2011 Ohio Associated Press Hall of Fame for broadcasting, 64 years in the business. And
really appreciate that.
Yeah, it's been fun. It really has. We've enjoyed having you in today, and
we'll
let you talk to some of the crew later on and explain some of these names. They have no idea.
That's right, sure. They'll think I made those up.
Yeah, exactly. But we appreciate you coming
in
very much.
Thank you so much. A pleasure.
Thanks for tuning in to this edition of Lang's Perspective. I'm Mike Miller, and remember, until we meet again, let's make a difference.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.